Hello and good morning, friends. Welcome to CEC EduSat Live Lecture. In today's session, we will be having an extensive discussion on multiculturalism. And for this, we have with us Dr. Anand Prakash, retired professor from Delhi University. We also have with us Dr. Urvashi Kuhar, assistant professor from Department of English, Ramlal Anand College, University of Delhi. Welcome,
thank
ma'am.
You. Thank you, Nayad.
Before wasting much time, let us begin our discussion.
Welcome viewers, and thanks Inayat for your kind words. Today we discuss multiculturalism, a very heavy word. We have heard about it a lot. We bring it in when we discuss literature, when we discuss social trends, sometimes even ideological trends. But I wonder whether I, for instance, understand multiculturalism in its various implications. So let me struggle to explain this word. For my benefit, and that will also be available for sharing with the viewers. In a country with a history, and some kind of a process through which the country passes towards modernism, some problems emerge. In our country also, those problems emerge. There was a time when we were a colony. I've been saying this in some other discussions also. And then there was a resistance to the colony, and the people rose first gradually and then just like that very dramatically, and the British had to leave, and that happened in 1947. So at that time our country was a kind of a community and a society that didn't understand the word democracy as much as it understands today. There was a caste system. The caste system still is there, but now it is it comes under critical surveillance. Then it was a fact, and all of us agreed that caste system is good for India. Then there were regions. They were not integrated into a kind of union that would make it a country. And as we look back now, after 60 or more years after independence, we realize that these two things have remained with us, and some play a negative role and some might also play a positive role. For instance, is India single cultural unity? Is India a single religious unity? Is India a single regional identity? This is the question that we can raise today. And what does democracy mean if we have a single culture, a single region, a single language, and all those things? Well, this is the difficulty we face. And then this question that we have different cultures in the country, and that these cultures first have to be accepted as existing, and then we have to evolve an attitude towards them. So this will bring in the idea of multiculturalism, that we have, let's say, a culture in North India, we have a culture around Punjabi language, for instance, we have a culture around Urdu, we have a culture around Hindi that is evolving. We also have a large number of other languages and cultures surrounding them. How do we bring them in a format where all of us exist peacefully, harmoniously, and under a perspective? So this is a question. It's difficult to answer, but in my opinion, in today's world, the multicultural framework, the multiculturalist framework, perhaps is the need of the hour. I say perhaps because some people may have an opinion that we don't require so many cultures. We require one dominant culture. So with this, for instance, I would like to ask Urvashi whether this makes sense to begin with.
Sir, definitely, as you said, we need to have we could have the idea of a composite culture, which is, or a unified culture to speak of. And that reminds me of the two languages, Hindi and Urdu, which were initially one language, and after independence we could see the bifurcation into the two languages, Hindi and Urdu. And also I may be digressing a little, but if we could discuss a little bit on the word Hindavi instead of the modern Hindi and Urdu. So and there was also a decline of the Urdu language after independence, which we can say that, but it's it's being revived as of now. So mm-hmm. we could see that the culture is definitely becoming more enriched in that sense, and the acceptance of another language as well, which had declined, makes it to be an idea of a unified culture, in my opinion.
Well, you have given a very good discourse on multiculturalism, and you have said that some kind of variety is needed, but then there has to be a kind of compositeness about it. So I would like to ask whether Inayat agrees with Urvashi, or there is a problem in Urvashi's discourse.
No, sir, I definitely agree with it. Mm-hmm. And as the progression took place of development of Urdu language, mm-hmm. as well as the Persian language, I noticed a point that now languages are being linked to religion. Mm-hmm. So Urdu came to be defined as somebody who belonged to a particular religion. Mm-hmm. Though gradually this was not the case. During the Mughal period or pre-independence period, Urdu was extensively used. Mm-hmm. So I think, I agree with ma'am, mm-hmm. and that is a great point that she has made.
And yeah, can I ask a question from you, Inayat?
For instance,
which country does Urdu initially, originally belong to? Could you make a guess?
Is it, no sir, India?
Well, you can guess. I'll give my answer later. Yes?
Sir, Iran, did it come from there?
Please make a guess.
I'm referring to the Persian script. So
yes,
I'm just guessing that
Persian
it
maybe
Persia,
exactly
yes.
developed from
so,
Persia.
So in a way, what you say is that if we use Roman script, then Hindi will become English.
No, sir. Again, in fact,
so script is not the deciding
script
factor.
Script is not the deciding factor. Exactly. This was also part of what I was reading recently, and it said that if we wrote Urdu in the Roman script, it doesn't become English language.
Mm-hmm.
So again, sir, please enlighten us, since we are confounded about this.
No, actually, all of us. I'm also equally confused, and I've been thinking about this problem, and that's how we are struggling to understand the character of multiculturalism. Now, there are certain facts. One fact, maybe you will disagree with me. One fact is that Urdu originally is from Delhi. It originated in Delhi. Didn't originate in Pakistan. There was no Pakistan at that time. It didn't originate in Afghanistan. Not in Iran. Nowhere else. It's an Indian language, but we don't know about it. And there is a reason for this. I also, for a long time, didn't know that Urdu was a language was born, that was created, that evolved in India. When I started thinking about it, then I realized. I read some books, and then it was, for instance, the one theory about the origin of Urdu is that people from different regions of India, and also from outside, they came to Delhi, and they came to Delhi as army groups, and they were called Lashkar at that time, and these people remained around Lal Qila, around Jama Masjid, for a number of years. Now, because they had come from different parts of India and parts of the world, they had to communicate in some language.
Right.
And they didn't have a single language. They came from their respective places, and there this language, no language was spoken that would be understood in Delhi. So what happened was that they started using idioms and phrases which came from the street. They might go to the market, they might pick up some words from there,
right.
Then they would come and communicate. So gradually, in the early 19th century, the Urdu language started forming itself. And for that, the script was, as you rightly say, the script was Persian, because that script, was used by, the rulers of India at that time, in their documents, in their legal documents, in their other documents. So, and that was, some people tell me, those who are lovers of Hindi, they in fact say that the Persian script is very good for use for fast writing, isn't it? So it had that advantage also, the Persian script. For Hindi, if you write Hindi, I'm a Hindi writer, but I don't mind saying all this. When you write Hindi, then you have to first write the letter, then you have to put a line above it.
Yes.
Then you have to do matras.
Matras.
Yes. In Urdu, the only matra generally that is there is no matra, but there are dots.
Dots.
And then it's written very fast, and words, letters combine so fast. Anyway, I don't want to go into the script part of it. But in the early 19th century, people started speaking the language which was neither Braj, which was very close to Delhi, nor Bangar, which was the Haryanvi language, nor the Awadhi language, from where people would come to Delhi also. So these dialects, and they had their own kind of literature. Urdu had no literature. The language of the street had no literature.
Right. Yes,
but
sir.
Then, these people started writing using Urdu in such a manner that, it became a vehicle of expression for a large number of people in Delhi. And then it was not called Urdu initially. Ghalib, when he talks about, of course, Ghalib uses Urdu sometimes, but generally the language uses Rekhta.
Right.
Rekhta means it's a straight language. In Hindi, the word became Khadi Boli. So I'm going into the history of this because I want to say that there is a kind of a culture in language, and this culture should be preserved. And in the case of Hindi or Urdu, and Hindi and Urdu words were used interchangeably.
Right.
There are Urdu writers today. They are called Urdu writers. They said, I'm a Hindi writer. Like there is a poet in 18th century India called Mir Taqi Mir. He says he's a Hindi poet. And Ghalib says in the 19th century that he is a Rekhta poet. So this word Urdu or Hindi, etc., they would be later on become rigidified. But in the natural evolution of languages, then this was the case. And it's a very rich kind of a context that we are discussing. Now, should we retain Urdu? Should we retain Hindi? Should we retain some words, etc.? Around this, there have been large number of confrontations among thinkers. For instance, the Indian National Congress in the early years of the 20th century, they thought about this question as to which language should become the vehicle of expression. And we have this idea of Gandhiji saying Gandhiji came from Gujarat, but he said he will not use Gujarati for communication.
Right.
He said he will use Hindi, and he brought out his newspaper in Hindi, and he knew English so well, he could communicate so well in English, and Hindi was not his forte.
Right.
He could not write, he could not speak Hindi very well, and yet he said this is the language that will communicate one's intentions there. So these are the niceties, these are the subtleties, these are the beauties of the evolution of a language, and they come from a certain culture. What kind of a culture helped Hindi or Urdu or the language of the street come up? This is the question. And there are people who use beautiful words for this kind of a culture. There is an Urdu poet, Firag Gorakhpuri. His actual name is Raghupati Sahai, but he calls himself Firag Gorakhpuri. He uses a beautiful word for this. He says Ganga Jamuni Sabhyata. Ganga Jamuni means Ganga and Jamuna. They flow separately for some time and then they join. And after that they become one.
Yes.
But their separateness is Ganga and Jamuna. And when they come together, it becomes Ganga. So we should not forget that Ganga actually is not one single entity. It has the waters of Jamuna.
Jamuna as well.
And in Allahabad, where Sangam exists, the confluence occurs there. You can see the different waters. Should we recognize the difference of those waters, or should we just say that it's Ganga? My answer is we should recognize the presence of those waters in the common water that is Ganga. Now this metaphor explains the nature of two or three cultures coming together, joining each other on their own terms, and even if they become one, they remain separate. So this should be always kept in mind, and this I believe throws some light on what can be called multiculturalism.
So if Urdu was the street language, Persian was the court language, where do we locate Hindi language?
Hindi and Urdu should be discussed. That's a good question. Hindi and Urdu should be discussed together.
Okay.
Interchangeably. They are not two languages. They are the same language. Sometimes the script is Persian, so you call it Urdu. But these things are attacked also.
Yes,
like I started my schooling in 1946 when I was 4 years. At that time I had to learn the Urdu script, this Persian script. And in 1947, after a year, the country became free, and that language and that script disappeared. So I didn't know, as a child, I didn't know what was happening. I found Hindi easier, in fact, at that point of time. A child doesn't know how to join letters, etc. But then after 10 or 15 years of my schooling, I realized that I had lost a language and touched with it, isn't it? So this way, you know, the language of the street is something that should be preserved, and the strength of the language comes from the usage in the street.
Sir, I would like to also interrupt you at this point and seek an answer to a certain query that's coming up in my mind. Is that we've talked about Urdu as a language of the streets, and also you discussed a metaphor where, you know, Ganga Jamuni, which means that the waters flow together. You cannot separate the water and say this is Ganga and this is this is water from Jamuna.
Mm-hmm.
Similar thing, you said that sir, we cannot talk of Hindi and Urdu in a separate way, and these two cannot really be divorced from one another.
Mm-hmm.
So how is it, sir, that Hindi became associated with Hindus and Urdu became associated solely with the Muslims?
That's a sad chapter of our history, because
Absolutely,
you know, we started bracketing languages with religions and faiths, and you know, there was a time when I joined my college, you know, Hansraj College, in the early years of the 60s, mid-60s I joined Hansraj College. Then we had a head clerk. I still remember his name. His name was Iqbal Narayan.
Okay.
Well, what a beautiful
interesting
name.
Interesting one.
Yes. Because, you know, the first word was Urdu, second.
Urdu.
And there were a large number of people then, you know, who would become somebody who would say Ram Prakash is Hindu. Somebody who is a Muslim would call himself Ramdeen. So the word Ram is common.
Yes.
So it was this kind of multiculturalism then. People existed together. People peacefully, you know, adopted all these words. Now I have to really work very hard to find a person, a Hindu, who has this kind of a name. Everybody, in fact, in one of my writings, I once used in a stanza in a poem, I said that the whole country today has become Chandra. In my locality, there are 20 people who are Subhash Chandra, Mahesh Chandra,
this Chandra.
What is so good about Chandra? Chandra, of course, gives us light and all that. There are people, you know, who become, Chandra, Prakash, this, that, etc. But then, why not other words? And now, the separation along religious lines is marked in the context of languages.
Absolutely.
So you can straight away call somebody by. I'm glad that we have Inayat here, and she's a proud Hindu, and she doesn't bother about the name. In fact, it's such a good name that she has. But you know, this is one part. So there must have been some kind of a politics in the early years of the independence where people started saying, use Hindi, don't use Urdu.
Right.
In the early years of I passed my exams in early exams in the 50s and later, and even till the other day, I think till the 70s, a standard question in a Hindi question paper would be, write correct English after reading the following wrong, correct Hindi after following the words in the paragraph that is given, and then, you know, it's called Shuddh Hindi. From Urdu you are supposed to make it Shuddh Hindi. So which means that Urdu was completely ousted from the scene.
Exactly.
So this kind of thing exists, you know, and students today, like you also, wouldn't have seen, you know, that subtly a language has been brought in, which is a good language. Hindi is a very good language.
Yes,
it has its own, you know, rich culture and all. This language has been adopted in such a manner that another language, which is also very good, that has been ousted from the scene.
Exactly.
So this is what has happened. And it's definitely tragic for us. We lose out because we are not multiculturalists.
Exactly.
We have so many languages, we have so many literatures written in those languages which will not be available to us now.
Exactly.
Just because we don't know the language.
Exactly.
And you know, when somebody quotes a sher is a couplet, in Hindi it's a doha, people say, oh, this must be a Muslim. And somebody writes this, says it's a doha, then they say, oh, he must be a Hindu.
So this
is something that we have to get over and try to understand literature in its true spirit of human experience, true spirits of human communication, human interaction, and what is generally called love, equality, justice, and all those things, tolerance. So this is what.
Yes. And sir, I'm just reminded of also a novel in this respect, which would also illustrate our ideas even better, is Anita Desai's In Custody,
mm-hmm.
where she specifically focuses on the decline of Urdu poetry. It's, swift dispersal after the independence, and she, shows the plight of an Urdu poet. So in my opinion, I think she has clearly brought out the idea within that, how the aura of poets and poetry recitation that used to take place in Chandni Chowk was being replaced by it becoming a commercial center.
That's true.
And people who had a love for Urdu poetry and the language were, instead to sustain themselves, had to shift to teaching Hindi or writing in Hindi. So that that sadness and that agony is portrayed in the novel.
That's true. And you know, this legacy of the two languages or many other languages, is there with us right from the time, you know, people started using language in a formal sense and communicating with people from other places.
Yes.
In fact, the new word was coined by Gandhiji at that time. It was not liked by the Hindi supporters at that point of time. Gandhiji used the word Hindustani.
Hindustani.
He said, don't adopt Urdu, don't adopt Hindi, adopt Hindustani.
Hindustani.
And Hindustani would be close to the masses.
Absolutely.
Close to the common person. And the Hindi lobby attacked Gandhiji for this. Premchand was in agreement with Gandhi at that time. And he also was attacked. And it is sad to note, you know, that a person of Yashpal's proportions, who was a leftist, who was a progressive, who was a secular, I don't know under what influence, sometime in the 40s, he wrote a novel, the title is Divya, he wrote a novel, it's a historical novel, and he started writing in a language that nobody except himself would understand. Because he was writing, he was using all the time, you know, Sanskrit words. And I was surprised to see, you know, that such a writer who otherwise writes so effectively, and he became a big name after Premchand, if somebody has to be, you know, considered as a writer of realism, it is Yashpal. But and in other novels, he uses that kind of Hindi or Hindustani or Urdu, and he knew Urdu very well. But in Divya and Amita, there are two novels where he just used Sanskrit words as if, you know, he was recreating ancient India.
Yes.
Without
yes.
knowing, you know, that in ancient India, Sanskrit was not spoken in the way he uses the words there. For instance, I just give you one instance to yours. The one instance is that somebody has to say Juta. And the word that Yashpal is using for Juta is Padatran.
Right.
Yes.
Imagine this.
It's complicated.
It's a complicated path. Path there means the foot. And Tran means it gives some kind of a respite to the foot. So that is what the Juta is. So Juta, Juti, and some other word, Khadam and all those things. But no, he would use the Sanskrit word for this. And this was the kind of, I am explaining how, you know, Hindi or Urdu, they finally became separate.
Separate.
So this is the way. It has some kind of a link, you know, also. Apart from this, you know, with economics, it has a link with, you know, society. It has a link with jobs. There has to be Hindi department, there is Urdu department.
The Urdu ones are such, we could count them on our fingers.
Yes, yes. And Urdu middle class, Muslim middle class also would like Urdu now to be separate from Hindi.
Yes, sir.
So I can't make sense of, you know, what the Urdu news reader would be saying on DD.
Yes,
but
sir.
If I, when I, you know, hear Urdu from Pakistan radio, then I can follow it. Because they are communicating, you know, to the
exactly.
masses. Here the Urdu is being shared by, scholars.
Scholars.
So this is the point there. And Hindi does the same. But the good thing about, you know, I'll finally shift from here to the other area in discussion. Finally, what has happened is that in Hindi writing, Urdu and Hindi are once again mixed in a manner that nobody can see whether it's Hindi or Urdu.
Absolutely.
And read a Hindi newspaper today. Read Jansatta, for instance. And realize that, and listen to, you know, people talking on the channels. They speak Urdu and Hindi as if, you know, they are the same language.
Sir, I had a doubt.
Yes.
I happened to think about it, that why is it that we have politicized languages like Urdu and Hindi, but we have readily accepted the language of English, irrespective of religion? Why such kind of hypocritical stand?
You are using very correct words. There is hypocrisy, you know, hidden in this. But I would like you to explain it a little further, because you have been facing this problem. You are a product,
sir,
of the English language.
Yes, sir.
So how did it happen in your case?
So I think the first idea why we have to accept English as a language was, I think it began when the colonists landed upon our country and the usage of English language started. But now, as we move ahead various centuries, and in the 21st century, why English is a necessity, I feel, is because of the globalization that has taken place, the need, the compulsory education in English, which, you know, puts us a bit forward in terms of competition. And I think not only that, the sense of hierarchy, we are made to believe that English is more of a superior language than other languages. But again, sir, if we make it a point to promote other languages, which of course the schools have made it a point by introducing Sanskrit, Urdu as other languages which can be pursued, then, sir, again, a lot of transition can be brought in. But yet again, sir, the way this is an important fact that came to my mind, and it can't be ignored, sir.
Definitely can't be ignored, and it has to be critiqued also. So, at this point, you know, so we have to go into the reasons why, you know, English emerges, and we'll later on discuss as to how, you know, through English somehow we are losing our identity.
Exactly, sir.
So I believe we should reach this conclusion, and then we can discuss something further.
Yes, sir.
Sir, just a tiny point I'm taking away from the discussion, but taking up from what Inayat had to say about why English was so readily accepted and the other languages had to struggle with themselves, is I'm just reminded also of a ghazal by Amir Khusro, which is also prescribed in the Delhi University syllabus.
Very good.
It's translated, and it says the language itself is, you know, it's a personification saying, "Forget me not." So if you could allow me to read
a line or two.
It says, "Forget me not, the sorrowful. Talk to me with your eyes, dear heart. I cannot bear the sorrow of parting. Keep me well within your heart." So here Hindi is seeking a place for itself, and as not being given the kind of place that it deserved, as opposed to English, which continued then even after independence to, you know, as an official language of the country. There were plans to remove it at some point, but it continued. So this is something that I was reminded of.
It's a good point you are making, Urvashi, regarding this, that, you know, one's own languages have to be adopted, have to be used. And perhaps, you know, some of us believe, you know, that English is a language that, you know, brings in modernization, as Inayat also pointed out. That is not the case, in fact. I've been to one or two countries. I went to Japan, and nobody uses English there. And Japan is more modern than us.
Yes.
I went. You also have gone to one or two countries. They have their own languages.
Exactly.
And but the way that English is used here. But you say this, you know, in writing, or you say it, you know, somewhere else in discussion. And English lobby is so strong.
Absolutely.
That they'll find, you know, 10 arguments against you, and they would say, well, how can Indian languages survive? There is something to say in favor of English also. At the moment, we don't have a single language in India through which, you know, we can communicate at the national level.
Absolutely.
Isn't it? And but somebody is responsible for this. Hindi was such a language. Other languages also could be such languages. I have no idea about the South and the East. But I think Bangla can be understood in Assam,
yes,
and Assamese can be understood in Bangla. Bangla can be understood also in Bihar. I've seen some areas, you know, where people and the language has gone all over. So the Indian languages are very strong, and they have a strong basis. The only problem now is that I think it's money power, it's business, it's a kind of investment opportunities, and it's also publications. You know, all of them have the support of the big money, and the big money is supporting English. And as Inayat was very rightly pointing out, adoption of English is somewhat connected with the privilege in society. You become superior. You become your status conscious, and you show others their place because you can speak English and others can't speak English.
Exactly.
So it is in a way becoming a cause for some kind of inequality in the country. From the language question, because this question is itself very tenuous, let's move to the question of you know, identities that exist in India. Identities, I say, identities mean a kind of selfhood, a kind of who I am, which language I speak, which culture I believe in, which faith I have, or, you know, what kind of, you know, behavior I have, what value system I have. Different identities, you know, in India exist. Can you, Inayat, count a few identities, a few regions in India which have not much in common with the other regions? Did you just name them?
So, I think the best way to define is the way geographical boundaries have been created.
Yes.
So perhaps the northern region is distinguished from the southern region, as well as the western and the northeastern region are well distinguished from each other.
Mm-hmm.
But
how many languages would northern India would have? Kashmir, Punjabi,
Hindi,
Rajasthani
dialect,
Sindhi,
Pahari language.
And languages in Bihar, Maithili,
Lakhnavi dialect.
Lakhnavi dialect, all these things are there.
Yes, sir.
Aren't they sweet, all these languages? They have their own, parameters of sweetness.
Yes, sir, absolutely.
Lakhnavi Hindi is supposed to be very, very courteous and all.
Yes, sir.
And Rajasthani language is to be very, very matter of fact. Haryanvi language is very, very assertive.
Absolutely.
So they have their own, strength and their own, characteristics.
Yes, sir.
Should they be preserved?
Absolutely, sir.
Yes, sir.
And if you have dominance of English education in all these places, then the middle classes and all the children who go to school, they will forget their own languages and they will speak in a standard English.
Standard English. Yes, sir. We need to keep that also alive. Parallel to, of course, if...
So identities are being eroded by
some
kind of a culture. So most of us, think, in our prejudices also sometimes there is a kind of racism, that is developing in the country.
Yes,
and
sir.
That is because, and there is a kind of caste system. There is an old caste system where there are Brahmins. There is a new caste system where there are English speaking people. So just see. So these caste systems, and they are permeating other areas of life. Hindi writers are these days adopting English for expression. A large number of very fine intellectuals, in Bengal, who otherwise would write in Bengali. The Tagore's descendants, for instance, and Sharad Chandra at that point of time, later on Tarashankar Bandyopadhyay, then all writers, Mahashweta Devi and all, they wrote in Bangla. But which are the writers who are writing in Bangla these days? I don't have a single name to go equal to Amitabh Ghosh and all. They are now writing in English. So this is one thing, is this Bangla culture and the Bangla culture of the peasant. Tagore is very close to the peasant and his sweetness.
Yes.
So very simple in his poetry, and that kind of sweetness is preserved in the Bangla culture. In Bihar, you have a kind of diversity. There are four or five languages in Bihar. Bhojpuri is there, and there is the Patna language and all. So, and we make joke of the Biharis, of Bengalis, of Punjabis, of Haryanvis. Why make jokes when these cultures have their own kind of strength? So this all these cultures should be kept, preserved in a manner that we don't lose track of the beauties hidden there in them. That's one part. Second thing that I want to problematize now, that part is that we have to move forward. We have to move towards a kind of cohesion. We have to get together as a nation. It will not work, that somebody is a South Indian, somebody is a North Indian. All of us are national citizens. There is a Constitution of India which says, that we are Indians, and we are Indians, of course. Now, how will this Indianness work out in a country which is a multiplicity of cultures? Multiplicity of languages, multiplicity of dialects. These things must have been there in Europe also, but they have all become now standardized.
Yes.
And are we moving towards standardization? And is standardization that important? Is a question. So the question is between a kind of preservation of tradition and a movement towards modernity. So what do we do about it? Say something.
Sir, it's slightly tricky, but as you said, we need to blend everything with one another, in the sense that we need to have that individuality of or an identity for each language or for each culture, but also we need to, when it comes to representing ourselves, we need to also have a cohesion in that sense. We need to see one another as of course as one. There needs to be a unified feeling. And at the same time, we could also preserve our unique culture, which is, it may vary, like Inayat said, from the northeastern to the southern India, and there's a unique, distinct culture that prevails. But keeping that in mind, if we are able to show respect for the other culture, then that also is a sign of unity.
Question is, how do we become modern? With modern education, scientific education, education of modern forms of expression. All these things have to be contented with. And when that happens, then we are sure to lose touch with those things, you know, which we call our own. And we have to move forward, for instance. We have to become modern, don't we?
Oh, absolutely, sir. We need to move with the times and not stay stuck in the traditions or practices that we have, you know, we were following probably 100 years back. So we do need to keep making modifications, and acceptance is the key, sir.
And there may not be a sense of justice in certain cultures. Those cultures having a sense of casteism and division. So do we preserve that sense of separation and not move towards justice?
So we definitely need to move towards justice and remove that kind of separation, which will come through. There has to be a change in the mindset for that.
And both of you are women. Now there are certain cultures where women, you know, are treated very shabbily.
Yes, I
can give examples of particularly two or three states. Now the sex ratio in Haryana, sex ratio in Punjab,
yes.
Sex ratio in Rajasthan. It's very, very, you know, horrifying, and it has a kind of culture which doesn't, you know, give initiative and freedom to women. So what do we do about it? Do we preserve Punjabi culture, Haryanvi culture, Rajasthani culture, and with the attendant part of women being subjected to all kinds of prejudices?
Not those particular aspects, not those particular parts of the culture which subjugates women, but as reference to the folk tales or the folk songs or the other cultural traditions could be kept in place, but definitely not the kind of mindset that was towards women that needs to change with the times, and also trying to learn from the other cultures how progressive they are. There are matriarchal cultures as well.
Yes,
so learning and taking up from that is to keep an open mind and perspective at the same time.
Do we have certain cultures where women are enjoying some privileges and some freedoms, unlike us in the North India, where they don't enjoy that kind of privilege and freedom? Do you have some idea about those cultures in India?
Yes, so we have in Northeast.
Yes.
The matrilinear societies can be found there.
Mm-hmm.
But sir, again, while we are discussing all this, another important theme that comes to my mind is the idea of tradition versus modernity.
Okay.
So when we are moving towards modernity, it is very important to retain the traditionality that exists. So the beauty of India is the diversity, the plurality,
mm-hmm.
and that is what we should retain. We should not distinguish ourselves on various differences that have existed. Instead, that is what makes us unique. That is what should bring us together when we are moving towards modernity. And we should retain the traditional aspect.
Traditional such as casteism?
Not really, sir. There are good aspects as well as bad aspects of every topic that we deal with.
What is the good aspect of casteism? I'd like to know. just talk to me.
No, I would like to say nothing in casteism, because the way it has been politicized.
Yes.
In the current times, it is only seen in a bad light, sir.
Mm-hmm.
And there is nothing, the intercaste marriages are something which are not looked positively by many,
mm-hmm.
and several other issues, sir.
Mm-hmm.
So, but there are other aspects of the traditional realm,
I would just like to add to
Inayat's point and recall also one of sir's previous lectures where he had discussed and told the audience about why the caste system actually came into place. It was just to diversify society into different roles and not for the purpose of discrimination.
Mm-hmm.
That was the purpose these things came into place, but people used it to monopolize the situation and also to put themselves in an advantageous place and place the others in a difficult situation and also degrade them.
I get your point that there was a time in history where caste system became somewhat necessary. But is it necessary today?
No, sir. Absolutely
no, sir.
Today, not. No.
Can you tell the reasons why?
Sir, it's become favoring the very few at the top, and it's discriminating the majority of the population. So it's basically a couple of people ruling or deciding things for the rest of the population, which is very anti-humanistic as well. So this is something that needs to be taken away, and this is not exactly this. It's not what our ancestors had in mind when they allotted these segregations.
Now, both of you have made some very good points regarding caste system and its critical nature, which should be understood. Now, I've met a large number of males. I interact with them more than I interact with women friends and intellectuals. I realize that most of the males have this tendency to somehow defend casteism of a kind, and women don't. So what is women's role in fighting casteism of the kind that brings in inequality?
So their role is also then in trying to give a reason and to also vindicate, if I can use Mary Wollstonecraft's term, is to vindicate their own position and also to justify and to clarify to them without demeaning them that what they're doing is wrong.
Which means that on the basis of absence of or removal of casteism, we can bring people together.
Yes sir.
And that unity will help infect the society better. Isn't
yes,
it?
Sir.
Agreed, sir.
That unity will have to sacrifice some aspects of tradition. Those have to be sacrificed. And but there are people. This is the problem with multiculturalism. Multiculturalism says retain most of the things that existed earlier in the name of identity. Now this new idea of this new concept of modernism, modernity, that says that you should allow people also to come forward as together. So women of Kerala, women of Maharashtra, women of Bengal, they should come together as women, as women workers, as women intellectuals. So that will unite them. In this unity, there is a danger of losing certain aspects of their own specific things. So should we lose that or not? I let me tell you my opinion. I think we should, because we have to unite against forces which want to keep us stuck to the past. We should live in the present and we should move towards the future.
Agreed, sir.
So some kind of a grand narrative, which is a word of abuse in modern critical theory, this word is to be accepted as a positive word. Because already we are fighting a narrative which is a grand narrative. How to fight that grand narrative? That grand narrative is of tradition, of for instance, some kind of an Indianization of everything. Indianization of the same around, something that is taking inspiration from tradition, as all of us pointed out. So we should all unite, as you use the word humanism, as human beings, as people who love dignity, people who love equality, and that equality and love and dignity, that they are spread across the country, and that unites the country and makes it stronger. So there is a discussion going on about this. Multiculturalists do not give much attention to this. They say you retain your ethnicity, you retain your old languages, you retain other things, and shun some kind of unity, because that unity will steamroll you. Now it has some positive points regarding this. For instance, I met a scholar from Australia the other day, and she told me that this kind of a modernity has crushed a whole population of Aborigines there, which is true.
Right.
So there are problems as well as there are certain answers. So how do we go in such a world, where a large number of issues are getting raised from different angles? What is your take on this?
So then the a better approach would be to integrate all of these ideas and try to perform a path which would not also make us do away with the kind of traditions, like you said, the Aboriginal population is being compromised in some way. So we need to chalk out a path where all of the culture is preserved at the same time. What cripples the culture needs to be done away with, or at least to find a solution to that.
My recipe for success. I ask you your recipe for success. Will lie in taking the ideas to women, giving them empowerment, bring them into education, compel them to think hard, compel them to also take risks. Because it is here, that there's some kind of a hope lies. What I find is that in most of the existing societies, privileges have been, squarely owned by a small group of people.
Yes.
Now, this
yes,
should
sir.
Be looked at critically.
Yes.
This should be analyzed also, and it should be then shared. The perspective should be shared with a large number of people. And if people wear around the idea of dignity and truth, etc., then I think that will be a good thing. What do you say?
Yes, sir. Indeed, sir. In fact, one point that was coming to my mind, that when we move forward towards modernism, we should retain the traditional aspects, not the negative ones, of course. Mm. And this is visible. Like, we tend to celebrate most of the festival these days.
Mm-hmm.
Christmas is something which was restricted, which is Christianity. But in today's days, these festivals like Christianity or Holi or Diwali, everybody celebrates it.
Mm-hmm.
they have become Indianized. So I think that is how the approach should be. Though, sir, there are certain elements which are still critical of these aspects, and again they politicize it. But it's never too late to accept it, and one should not go back to the past, but move ahead in the future by taking forward the positives of the past, not the negative ones.
What about the positive of the present?
Of course, sir, the present too. But again, sir, this is again problematic, because every individual's definition of what is positive and what is negative varies. There is a blurred line. So for me, something might be positive. For the other person, that might be negative. So what should we take ahead? Yes. What should we leave behind is what needs to be addressed.
One kind of celebration and new festival or all those things would be, you know, like celebrating birthdays.
Yes.
It's not in our tradition.
Yes, sir.
But we enjoy it.
Yes,
and that brings us together.
Exactly. Yes,
sir. So that should be kept.
Yes.
Free mixing
of men and women in society.
Yes, sir.
Yes,
yes, sir.
Organizing, poetry readings, organizing,
yes,
organizing dances, organizing,
yes,
plays, etc.
Yes,
these are the new things.
Earlier,
they were confined to just a few people. Now, I think we should bring in all
extended
these.
Extended to.
Yes, sir.
And we should be. Jokes can be used in culture, but jokes should not be used at the cost of anybody else.
Exactly.
And we should not hurt the sentiments of others.
Definitely.
That should be kept
in
mind. So I think rightly both of you have said that some of the positive aspects of life, they have to be imbibed, and we should also locate the negative aspects, which can be first located and then consistently criticize, so that finally we are able to become one with our dignity and integrity intact.
And I'd like to applaud the recipe for success that you have just shared with us. I think it's something that it's been the greatest feminists have been aiming at it, and it's also been accomplished to a great extent, but we still need to go a long way in terms of giving women opportunities to education, and then it is for the others to see whether the women are really capable of achieving any great heights or not, just by diminishing their attempts or just by dismissing their attempts to to do greater things by saying that it would make women too manly, or that the purpose of women is only to please men or take care of the household, are arguments that have been dismissed previously, and attempts have been made to share this very same idea which you said. So give them education, give them an ability to develop their minds and to think independently, and then that is a fair chance for them to develop, and then we could be able to decide things such as, do they really deserve it or not.
And what do you say?
So I agree with what Urvashi ma'am has said. In fact, I think the way the individual mindset works is according to the need that exists at that time. So, sir, what I feel is, when the idea of multiculturalism comes into talking, the boundaries are constantly shifting. For example, sir, when a set of South Asian friends meet abroad, they forget the religion they belong to or the country. They are united more on the basis
That's
of
a good example,
yes.
More on the basis of race. And they become one then. So, sir, all these cultural and social aspects are self-created. Otherwise, we all are one. Because that's what we are doing. We are constantly blurring the boundaries, shifting as per our need. So this is a point which I think should be critically looked into. That what exactly are we doing? Is this really needed, or can we just stand as a whole? United we should stand. That is what our thinking should be. Because at a certain level, the very people who are Indianizing things or talking about things on the basis of belonging to a certain country, the idea of nationalism, they all are united when they meet outside, when they interact together, and they forget the country or the religion. The languages are also very similar. So everything stands vanished that time.
With respect to this point, as well as to the one that Urvashi has raised, the scene doesn't seem to be as bright, as we thought it would be. For instance, the gender ratio, the sex ratio, is still not good enough.
Yes,
so women have to work really extra hard. Look at the constitution of the Indian parliament. How many women do we see in the Indian parliament? In the country, they are supposed to be 50%.
Yes, sir.
There they would be 45, 6, etc. But there, in the parliament, they are hardly 10%. And who will take care of this particular aspect if women are not there to represent not only women but also the whole of the country? The same is true about the ratio in bureaucracy and in judiciary.
Yes, sir.
And in army, of course, there is only a smattering of women, but most women are not there. They can fight as well. And there are many wings in the army where women perhaps score better. So, you know, all these questions have to be considered, and they are a part of the multiculturalist format, because then these new questions will come and bring the cultures together.
Right.
And bring the cultures together through bringing women together, bring you know, the educated people together, bring the middle classes together, and their middle classes of different communities, teachers, they are doctors, they are other people, they will, you know, come together with others, they will carry their ideas to their own community, and they will carry the ideas of their community to other communities. So, which means, it will be, so the final word that I would use for this would be, of course, it's a oft repeated and it's a kind of a cliche now, that there has to be unity, but then in diversity.
Absolutely.
If you are not able
to
retain diversity, If the diversity of even one, I may have a view and I may disagree with you, you may have a view and you may disagree with others, but then till you have that view, you have the right to express that view and retain that view. So that is what diversity means. Unity means that when it comes to the larger questions of equality, etc., then we come together. But we come together not because others are putting pressure on us, we come together because we are convinced. So this, you know, being educated, being cultured, being tolerant, being understanding, being sympathetic, these are the modern values, and they don't fight against the ethnicity and other things, because they say you imbibe these values, in fact you will be a better Bengali, you will be a better Haryanvi if you are a modern person than if you are in a tradition bound. So this is what multiculturalism finally means, viewers. I hope our viewers have enjoyed this. And our anchor will now sum it up. Please do.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir, for today's valuable session. Friends, it was a very interesting lecture which happened today as we explored the boundaries and varieties of the aspects of multiculturalism. We will be having more such session in the future and the upcoming days. Thank you and goodbye.